We will talk about a very, very important and interesting topic of hypergonadotropic hypogonadism in females. And we all know that in comparison with boys, we have got more likelihood of having hypergonadotropic hypogonadism in girls. And most of these cases turn out to be Turner syndrome. But today what we'll do is that we'll talk about four interesting cases who turn out to be non-Turner, who have presented with hypergonadotropic hypogonadism, and all of them were congenital. So we're talking about very early onset hypogonadism because of a probable ovarian etiology beyond Turner. And this is an important area to look at in girls presenting to us with delayed puberty, with primary amenorrhea, and how do we evaluate and assess from there is what we're going to discuss. So I'll start off with this flag case of a 17-year-old girl with primary amenorrhea who presented with stage 4 development and stage 4 pubic hair development. And she was tall. When we inquired, the major complaint was primary amenorrhea, but she had visited the doctors with complaints of absent pubertal development and had received estrogen therapy. And when we did a workup, we found that the karyotype was high. Now, at this point of time, what do you think? There are no features of Turner syndrome. There is no short stature. Do we need to do anything else from here, Sain? We already know that this is a case of hypergonadotropic hypogonadism. Gonadotrophins are high. Turner's is unlikely given the code. There are no clinical features. She's tall, and short stature is the most common manifestation. The further workup, would you like to do anything else, or will you like to start estrogen?
As you mentioned, a tall stature. Would you like to do a cardiogram?
Why?
So because XY gonadal lesions.
So this is an important message. So what is important to understand is that any individual who comes to you with hypergonadotropic hypogonadism, it is absolutely mandatory to do a karyotype, because it's not just Turner syndrome that you're looking at. This girl turned out to be a XY individual and turned out to be, and we'll discuss such cases subsequently, a particular situation of SRY defect in which gonadectomy was required in that perspective. So it's very important to understand that hypergonadotropic hypogonadism, we have to do a karyotype. And only when the karyotype is normal, you start thinking of other possibilities. And you can always think that XY DSP may be a cause of hypergonadotropic hypogonadism. Now, we know that XY DSD is an act of omission. So any act of omission, be it gonadal formation, testosterone biosynthesis, conversion of testosterone to dihydrotestosterone, or androgen receptivity, any of these defects will present like a normal female appearance with primary amenorrhea. So that's why XY DSD is an important differential which happened in this case. We'll discuss about this and other cases as well in that regards. So if we talk about delayed puberty overall, we know that compared to boys, the chances of having physiological causes is less in girls, but still it is 30 to 40%. There is also a higher likelihood of having a hypergonadotropic hypogonadism. And therefore, you will have more of what we are discussing today. In boys, the numbers is usually less, but in girls, it's much more important from that perspective. Now, you can all have a look at our different courses, which are available on our website. We do perform twice a month grand rounds related to both postgraduates as well as more for the fellows. There are also books which are available in our website and the application which we'll try to use and the fellowship which has recently been launched. So what we'll do today is that we'll talk about four interesting cases, all of them presented with primary amenorrhea, and all of them had no breast development. So this is more like a congenital form of hypogonadism. All of them had a sky-high FSH. So this is hypergonadotropic hypogonadism. And they had a normal karyotype. So these are these three cases. And that's why we'll discuss about these. So they had subtle clinical pointers which highlighted toward a particular diagnosis, which we'll discuss from that. So just to summarize as to what are the possible causes we are thinking about when we talk about congenital hypergonadotropic hypogonadism, we're talking about problems either in the ovarian development per se. So we're talking about gonadal dysgenesis. The classical example is Turner syndrome. But now we know that there are multiple genes which are regulating the development of the ovaries. So if they are defect in either, so it can either be a XXDSD or a XYDSD, which is manifesting as a female, there can be multiple problems. We'll discuss about that. Then there could be a steroidogenic defect right from the start in the axis of formation of estrogen. And they can be combined with the adrenal abnormalities in the form of STAR, side chain cleavage, and 17-hydroxylase, or they can be isolated like 17-beta-HSD and aromatase, which we'll discuss subsequently, which can cause these problems. Now, important thing to remember is that while gonadotogenesis is associated with global failure as far as ovarian function, steroidogenic defect will have a selective effect on these steroidogenic cells. But what will happen to their fertility potential, Naveen? If you have a complete estrogen deficiency, let's say in the setting of aromatase deficiency, in the setting of STAR defect, what will happen to their reproductive potential, or let's say how their oocytes will work?
No, sir. There will be a problem with this.
Why?
Because germ cells and both are actually essential for
the... So while the development of the germ cells and the estrogen producing cells, or let's say the granulosa cell and the ceca cells, is separate, both are essential for their mutual development. If you have complete estrogen deficiency, now I'm talking about complete estrogen deficiency, there would be a luteinization of the follicle. So the follicle will actually die off early. This is very important. When we talk about complete, we mean nothing is being produced. So if you have zero estrogen, we have seen patients with aromatase, we have seen patient with 17-beta-HSD, 17-hydroxylase who have got zero AMH, which is basically because their oocytes have died because they did not get any estrogen which had a protective effect for the oocyte. That is important. Now, if you compare with somebody who has a hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, let's say Calamine equivalent, you have got no LH, no FSH, why are they then having some potential of fertility? When you give them FSH or LH, they respond. Why don't their oocyte die? You're saying that estrogen is essential for their follicular growth, but in that setting of isolated HH, they still respond later on. Pratik, what do you think? So if you remember your physiology correctly, the initial production of estrogen or the initial follicular growth is FSH independent. Only once your follicle reaches around 4 to 5 mm, your FSH work starts to occur. So if you have zero estrogen producing capacity, which means even paracrine estrogen is not being produced, you don't have any production there, you will of course have a problem. But even if you don't have LH or FSH, some amount of androgen, some amount of estrogen will be locally produced, which will be enough to save those oocytes, which can then be used later on when you give them gonadotropin. So this is the difference between these. But remember, steroidogenic defects of severe form will also have, in a way, gonadal failure. So it's both mutual. Don't expect that one way or the other things will be affected. So AMH levels will be low in most of these conditions, and they are not discriminatory, so to speak, between a primary gonadal problem and a primary problem in the steroidogenic pathway. So now if you talk about congenital hyper-hypo, we can classify them as the estrogen deficiency, which is pretty much the most common cause. And this deficiency can be because of gonadal dysgenesis. Now, this dysgenesis could be XX as well as XYs. That's what we are saying, that many of these XY defects, if they are severe, they will present just like a normal phenotypic female with delayed puberty and primary amenorrhea. Now, if you look at gonadal dysgenesis in the XX part, the one on the left, most common is, of course, Turner syndrome. But you see, there are so many genes which are involved in ovarian development. And if you have a defect in any of them, you will also have a similar picture. They may not have phenotypic characteristics of Turner syndrome. So if you don't have phenotypic characteristics of Turner syndrome, start thinking of other possibilities. Very important things out of these are actually myotonia. And many of these neurological anomalies are also associated. The fragile X-related anomalies are also reported more commonly. There are many of these genetic defects as well as autosomies which cause that. Now, if you look at XYDSD, again, any condition which causes complete testicular dysgenesis, you will have a similar picture. Now, Manoj, what is the difference between clinically between a XX gonadogenesis and a XY gonadogenesis? Both are presenting with no breast, no pubic hair. What is the most important thing you'd like to look at? Yes. So if you have somebody who is tall, when you say tall, you're basically talking about a male height. That itself is 13 centimeters higher than a female height. Start thinking of a XY DSD, and that will be relevant in one of our cases, which I think you will discuss in that perspective. On the other hand, if somebody is really short, you are thinking of Shox defect. So Shox is gone. So that means it goes more like a XX gonadogenesis, mostly Turner's. Normal height, you're talking about many of the other disorders in which they should not be affected. So height is a very, very important pointer toward the diagnosis in congenital hypergonadotropic hypogonadism. Now, the other way around is, of course, biosynthetic defect. And this can, of course, happen in because of pathways which can happen. And you can also have a problem in the gonadotropin resistance. This is rare in that perspective. Now, steroidogenic defect can start from a defect which is very proximal, star and side chain cleavage. Now, how would Dr. Vibha star and side chain cleavage deficiency present as? Adrenal insufficiency along with salt wasting and ovarian abnormality. So the star defect is unique that it has got the two hit model. We have been discussing that if you have the first hit, this steroidogenesis comes down to around 15-20%, but that is enough to avoid salt wasting. Now, once the cholesterol accumulates in the cell, it will cause damage and destruction of the cell, which is the second hit model. And you have a delayed adrenal insufficiency happening around 2 to 3 months of age. But when does the ovarian insufficiency happen? Do they have any breast development or not in star defect? Sayan?
So they will have a breast development because the follicles are inactive during the prepubertal stage. So when puberty progresses, 70% activity will be there. So some form of breast development.
So there is a dichotomy in the presentation in boys. Testis is very active during fetal period. So testis is destroyed. So they will present with right in the fetal testosterone deficiency will happen. While ovaries, as far as the steroidogenesis is concerned, is quiescent. So ovaries are preserved. With every cycle, a new follicle comes up. So what will happen is that this follicle will go up to a particular stage. It will produce some amount of estrogen, which will cause some breast development, but it is not enough to cause periods or definitely in terms of ovulation in that perspective. So star defect will present with delayed salt wasting and delayed puberty plus minus mainly as primary amenorrhea. Now this is for the classical star. If you have a milder defect, the salt wasting may not be there. Then they will present more like a estrogen deficiency. They will have a typical presentation more like a PCOS like presentation. Large cyst can also develop because FSH is high. Large cyst will start appearing in that perspective. What about 3-beta-HSD? How would 3-beta-HSD deficiency present with Naveen?
Sir, they also can present with, they can start there.
So if we talk about classical 3-beta will present with?
So they usually present with salt wasting in the HF promoter
and
puberty.
And DSD.
And DSD.
Because the androgen levels will be high. While the milder form will present absence of salt wasting, but will present with hyperandrogenism. So they are not the differential here. So I'm not considering 3-beta-HSD as a differential here because they will present more with hyperandrogenic features like PCOS. That will be more likely in that perspective. How would 17-hydroxylase present, Manoj?
So 17-hydroxylase present
with hypertension. Yes. Why is the hypertension there?
Because there is increased mucopurticle activity.
So what is happening is that your entire steroidogenic pathway is going towards the mineralocorticoid. It is not going towards the glucocorticoid. It's not going towards the androgens and estrogen, of course, because estrogen requires androgen to be formed. So 17-hydroxylase will basically present with hypertension, hypokalemic alkalosis, and delayed puberty. Now, very importantly, any girl with hypertension and sexual infantilism, whether they are gonads or not, think of 17-hydroxylase deficiency, because if it's a XY DSD, you may have inguinal gonads. If it's a XX DSD, gonads may be absent. The clue there would be hypertension, but we'll discuss how hypertension may be missed or it may not be very significant in the initial phase. So theoretically, we talk about everybody should become hypertensive, but sometimes it may be variable in that perspective. Dr. Pratik, how would 17-beta-HSD present with?
In females, sir, according to what studies have mentioned, they might present with underutilization as I've been presenting, or they might completely be asymptomatic and incontinent.
So if you have complete 17 beta HSC deficiency, you will basically present just like a absent, like a estrogen deficiency. XY, you will present like a normal looking female with inguinal gonad. So XY complete 17 beta HSD will present like a female who has gonads. XX will present with a female without gonads. If you have a partial activity, you will have partial development, which will of course be dependent upon different perspective. So we talked about star SCC 17 hydroxylase 17 beta HSD. What about aromatase sign? How will aromatase classical and non-classical present?
Classical has complete estrogen deficiency. So there will be a history of maternal fertilization and there will be a DST at birth. But the size of that phallus will not increase.
Yeah.
And then again, the child will present at the pubertal age with delayed puberty. Now, the non-classical aromatase deficiency may have mild estrogen production from the placenta, but not from the ovaries. So they'll only present with signs of delayed puberty.
So aromatase deficiency will present if in the classical form as DSD with maternal virilization, which is very clear. But you can also have a differential as far as the differential for PCOS. So as 3-beta-HSD is a differential, mild aromatase deficiency may cause hyperandrogenism during adolescence because that's again the time when androgen production will increase. What will be the closest differential to aromatase deficiency? So aromatase deficiency presents with large cysts, high FSH, low estrogen, high androgen. Which other steroidogenic defect, which I have not mentioned here, can also cause entirely the same picture? So, can you think of it? POR. So, oxidoreductase deficiency, because POR is essentially a cofactor. And if it is not working, aromatase will not work. Because it's, and 17 hydroxylase will not work. So, that is the cofactor. So, POR can be there. So, these are the key steroidogenic defects that we'll discuss. And many of these will come up in the cases that will come up. That's why we are focusing more. Now, gonadotropin resistance can also cause a picture of quote-unquote hypergonadotropic hypergonadism. What is the difference between the manifestations of LH receptor defects in boys and girls, Dr. Manoj?
So, LH receptor defect in boys. So, there is a delayed puberty in boys, but in case of the female, there is only on ovulation.
And FSH receptor defect? So the main thing to remember is that the predominant gonadotropin in boys is LH. The predominant gonadotropin in girls is FSH. I'm talking in a very simplistic fashion, but this is something very easy to understand. If your LH receptor is not working, in a boy, you will have no pubertal development. That will be like a primary delayed puberty, complete, congenital. While if LH is not working in female, you can still have normal development. The only thing which will not happen is ovulation may not happen. On the other hand, if the FSH is not working in a boy, you can still have puberty, but there will be infertility. While if FSH is not working in a girl, you will have complete congenital deficiency, which is there. What about the third situation which I'm writing, pseudo-hypoparathyroidism? How does it present?
Short stage around this is
the age of puberty. About puberty. No, about puberty. But that is, of course, pseudo hyperparathyroidism. What will be the FSH level in that setting? Not very high. So they are not as high as Turner's. They will be like 20, 30. In Turner's, we'll see much higher levels. Then we'll talk about how all these patients have very sky high level. So this will become important. And then we have got a final differential, which is estrogen receptor defect. How would estrogen receptor defect present with Dr. Vibha? What will be the height of these patients, estrogen receptor defect? Short or tall? And their bones will not fuse because they have estrogen is essential for epiphyseal fusion. So they will have long bones, but weak bones. That will be the presentation. They will have no breast development. And this is the classical, but this is very, very rare. So what we're going to focus today, we've got four cases. Few of them are steroidogenic defect. There are one which is XX and one which is a XY DSD. So we've got these three boxes covered. And these are the most common things that we'll discuss today in more detail. Now, when should we consider a impaired estrogen effect? Of course, if there are features of delayed puberty, no thalarchy by 13 years, no menarche within 3 years, of thalarchy or secondary amenorrhea, which is defined as 90 days if you have regular cycle, and 6 months if there are irregular cycles. And sometimes, rarely, although when I talk about congenital, this is out, they will present more with oligomenorrhea. And that would be age and post-menarchal related timing as far as the number of periods is concerned. So less than 4 period in the first year, less than 6 between 2 to 4, and less than 8 after 5th year will consider as oligomenorrhea. So oligomenorrhea, amenorrhea, primary amenorrhea, secondary amenorrhea, and delayed puberty. This will be a whole spectrum of presentation. Congenital, of course, will present mostly with no breast development in that regards. And of course, the FSH will be high. And what's high? What FSH do you consider high?
In the clinical context, more than 10, we can say, more specific.
Yeah, so when you want to distinguish between hyper versus hypo, I think 10 may be a reasonable number to go, but usually the numbers are very high when we talk about Turner's and other aspects in that situation. Now, other things to look at is, of course, the weight. If somebody is obese, think of Turner's and PHP. Somebody has got polydactyly, think of Lawrence-Mohn-Beetle syndrome. If there is deafness, think of Turner's and pseudohypoparathyroidism. If there is brachymetacarpia, again, Turner's and pseudohypoparathyroidism. If the height is less, so we talked about short stature, it is a Shock's defect. If height is more, we are talking about XYDST. If height is normal, we are talking about probably some form of a normal XXDST. And we have got all three range, which we'll discuss soon on that regards. And of course, if there is hypertension, think of 17-hydroxyl deficiency, but also Turner syndrome would be the most common cause in that setting. Very important, and this is what we have been talking a lot about, that always look at pubic hairs. When you're looking at a child with delayed puberty, look at pubic hair, because pubic hairs are coming from a normal adrenal origin. So if you have got breast development with pubic hair, what does it mean? It means that there is no problem in maturity of the child. The child is having a normal maturity. So CDGP is out. There is a discrepancy between the gonadarchy and the adrenarchy. And therefore, this goes most likely in favor of GnRH deficiency. Turner syndrome, also you can have pubarchy, but it will be slightly less compared to normal because bone age may be slightly, the maturity may be slightly low. Let's put it this way. If, on the other hand, if you have no breast development and you have got no pubic hair development, the most likely possibility will be constitutional delay of puberty and growth. Second would be a systemic illness. Because of systemic illness, you are not having enough adrenarchy or gonadarchy. Third possibility would be if you have a multiple pituitary hormone deficiency and ACTH is also less. So these three will all have one thing in common, short stature. So short stature with no pubarchy, no thalarchy, think of CDGP, MPHD. And third would be a systemic illness. But if you have a tall child who has this phenotype, what would you think of, Nami?
A tall child, you can think of estrogen action defect. You can think of steroid defect.
Yeah. So there is a problem of either estrogen synthesis or action. That will be the most likely thing. So mostly clinically, if you talk about CDGP, illness will be the most likely. But MPHD plus estrogen defect can be the most important cause to think of. If you have normal breast development, no pubic hair development, and no menarche, Dr. Vibha, diagnosis? Good breast development, sparse pubic hair, primary amenorrhea. This is delayed puberty. Manoj? 5-alpha reductase. Anything else? Androgen insensitivity syndrome. You've got no pubic hair development. 5-alpha reductase, don't you virilize? You've seen the patient who virilized during puberty. So this is classical AIS. There is no confusion on that. If you have normal breast development, normal pubic hair development, amenorrhea. Diagnosis? Local cause, so Mullerian agenesis. Plus, you can think of hirsutism. If somebody has got hirsutism, think of PCOS presenting as primary amenorrhea. So the most important thing to look at in a girl with delayed puberty, and we'll use this a lot in this grand round, is pubic hair and height. These two will give you a lot of factors in that regard. This is what we're going to try to build up in that situation. This is the simplistic algorithm which we've discussed earlier also. do screening tests, CBC, SGPT, creatinine, TSH, TTG. Once you've excluded that, if gonadotropins is low, think of a hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, think of MRI. But we are interested here. If your FSH is high, and we have talked about FSH of 10, there is no clear-cut cutoff at what level you should consider to be high. But I would say if it's more than 10, at least get a karyotype done. If karyotype shows exo or mosaic, it is Turner's. I think that's the end of the story. That's a different ballgame altogether. We're not going to discuss that. If it is XX, now what do you do here is a debate. Whether you do a targeted genetic panel in everybody. Because 10 to 20% of what we know as premature ovarian insufficiency may have some of those genetic defects. We'll show one case how doing NGS could help you pick up a diagnosis. But whether it's required everybody becomes difficult. Steroid metabolites are expensive. It may not really change your management. So it depends upon how much the patient can afford. And if you have hypertension, hypokalemia, then you definitely it is required. Otherwise, it is plus minus. Calcium phosphorus alkaline phosphatase and the antibodies, again, more likely to be because of PHP or autoimmune association. Again, not very common, but depending on the clinical picture, you can do it like a baseline workup. If it's XY, then again, doing a genetic workup will help you because then you have to decide about gonadectomy. A lot of other issues are also important. And then probably testosterone and...
15-year-old girl who presented to us with chief complaints of short stature and absent secondary sexual features. The child was appearing short to the family members for the last 5 to 6 years with respect to his peers, her peers. There was no breast development or any menstrual bleeding. There was no family history of delayed menarche in mother or delayed shaving in the father. No history of any illness or hospital admission or any regular drug intake. No history of headache, vomiting or visual problems. No history of decreased smell or hearing loss. No history of cold intolerance, hair loss, weight gain. No history of weakness, recurrent infections. No history of maternal virilization during pregnancy. And no history suggestive of seizures. Now coming to the general examination, her blood pressure was normal. All the peripheral pulses were well palpable. No obvious squint or midfacial defects or external ear anomalies. No features suggestive of Turner syndrome. No brachymetacarpia, no cutaneous calcifications.
So now if you see here, how is she different from the other girl?
She's short, along with delayed
puberty. This is a parameter that there is height is less. What about the pubarchy?
No pubarchy.
So again, so she, now we talk about this girl becomes, in that situation, you have got short stature along with complete delayed puberty. Mm-hmm. No pubarchy, no thilarchy. Mm-hmm. So what are the possibilities you're thinking of?
So here I'll think of CDGP. Second, I'll think of any functional hypogonadism with respect to systemic illness. And third, MPHD.
Yeah, so that will be the most likely clinical parameters. Now, so let's go further.
Now on systemic examination, her cardiac examination was normal and there was no anosmia. Now the differentials, as Sir just asked, will be a CDGP, an MPHD, a functional hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, and extending further the same, any cause of hypergonadotropic hypogonadism, just like the case Dr. Pratik just mentioned, of any 17 beta HSD deficiency.
But then short stature, so that's something, these are all not absolute pointers. These are all more like a weighted pointers. So you can't just say that if the child is short, it can't be that. But yes, the likelihood of others become more likely.
Now on investigations, the child had a borderline raised TSH of 11. The rest of the investigations, which I am showing you at this point, are normal. LH was 24 and FSH was 75 in this case.
So all the case that we have seen, FSH was 75, 100, 890. So it's pretty high. That's what it's very, very clear.
An anti-TPO antibody status was done, which was normal. And the most important investigation of a karyotype revealed a normal karyotype of 46XX.
So again, we have a congenital hypergonadotropic hypogonadism because there is no breast development with a normal karyotype and a high FSH. Mm. So now what are you thinking of?
So clinically, looking at the picture, systemic illness is ruled out. Now, MPHD...
So out of those four, your MPHD is out, systemic illness is out, CDGP is out. So all are out. Mm. So this is hypergonadotropic hypogonadism on the right side. So what are you thinking of?
Sir, as you just mentioned, congenital. So we have to always keep in mind the possibility of a gonadal dysgenesis.
Yes.
Or any congenital.
Now this is important. Like as we say, Turner's can also present sometimes with B1, P1 if your bone age is not that much advanced. Any of the gonadal dysgenesis which causes short stature will also present like that. So that becomes important from that. And some steroidogenic defect which is causing failure to thrive. Although it's unlikely because you will have much more failure to thrive by this time.
So, so in only gonadal dysgenesis, pubic hair will be present?
But if your bone age is delayed,
okay.
The cadenarche has not triggered it. That may happen sometimes, but theoretically, yes.
So the diagnosis at this point of time is a hypergonadotropic hypogonadism. Now, taking the case further, as sir just mentioned in his previous speech, that not in every case will we think of a genetic diagnosis. Now, what happened in this case was that the child was doing well on hormone replacement therapy. Suddenly, after 4 years, his father again presented with his sister with
and
the same.
Did she develop pubic hairs as well?
Nothing. Not even pubic hairs.
No pubic hairs.
Yes.
On follow-up.
Yes. No, the patient which I...
On treatment.
No, this patient developed pubic hairs.
So on treatment, she had periods also. She had pubic hair also. So it means it was more like a maturation issue rather than any other problem.
Her sister also didn't have any breast development. Neither did she have any pubic hair development. So the family didn't have any consanguinity. Now, this is where we started to think of any genetic defects driving the complaints of both the sisters.
So Naveen, when do you think of a genetic cause in a particular disorder?
Sir, before when it is too early, syndromic features are there, and if it is sequestration presents,
segregation. Yeah.
Segregation.
So too soon, too syndromic, or segregation and severe. So this case is not soon. This case is not severe. This case is not syndromes, but there is segregation. So now you've got, there is a family history. Suddenly, if you have two girls having the same, it can't just be a coincidence. So what inheritance are we talking about?
So autosomal recessive.
So this is clearly an AR situation. Now this girl was not born to a consanguineous family, but she was born in a family where community consanguinity was more common. So in a way, that's why the likelihood of having a consanguineous disease was more likely. In this setting, so this all fits into autosomal recessive condition. So not just that parents may be consanguineous, you may have an overall gene pool which is common, which may happen. Maybe long time ago there might be some association. So that becomes important. So that's why genetic evaluation becomes important.
So the genetic analysis which was done revealed a defect in the spider gene and also in the SYCE1 gene. Now, the spider gene mutation was pathogenic and the second one was of unknown, uncertain significance. But in this context, this will become significant.
Okay, yeah, carry on. But if you have one gene, which is homozygous, that becomes significant. Why do you have to have another gene? You can't have two genes causing the same problem in a girl. This was homozygous.
Yes, sir. This was homozygous.
Homozygous. And so it is a recessive, sir. This is pathogenic. So this will be the cause.
Okay.
So you will pick that as a major cause rather than the other.
So coming to the review of literature of this genetic defect. Now, what is this gene involved in? Now, this gene is essentially involved in homologous recombination repair. It repairs any disorders of homologous recombination. Now, and it is highly expressed in the ovaries. Now, where does this homologous recombination come into? It essentially plays a role in meiosis. So what is the first selection which occurs in any ovarian follicle? The first selection occurs in case of a meiosis. Now, if the first selection is problematic, all the follicles will be destroyed.
So you will have a very early onset oocyte destruction which will happen. So in Turner's, we say that you can reach a normal peak, but your fall is accelerated. So maybe by 1 year, 2 years, your follicles are gone. Here, not even your follicles will be formed, because for a germ cell to be identified as ovary, has to undergo meiosis. If meiosis is defective, you won't enter that.
Now, coming to the second defect, this gene is essentially involved in preparing the synaptonemal complex. Again, this is involved in the homologous recombination process. So problems in this gene what happens with problems in this gene is that again, the meiosis is arrested at prophase. Again, the selection of all the follicles are destroyed and we have an early onset gonadal dysgenesis. This is mainly seen in if as I just mentioned, in heterozygous individuals having a heterozygous defect, these patients don't present with such problems. They're essentially normal. Just as the report I just showed you, our patient also had a heterogeneous defect. So most likely this defect is not contributing to her problem. Only the So this was a case of hypergonadotropic hypogonadism. The etiology was a gonadal dysgenesis, most likely due to a spider gene mutation.
So I think this is a very, very interesting case, and it highlights the importance of doing genetic testing. Now, we don't recommend that every girl who has a normal karyotype and who has hypergonadotropic hypogonadism, you do a NGS. It's not cost effective. We also did not do this. But here, once the family history comes into the picture, that becomes important, and this may have implications in terms of genetic counseling, in terms of other factors later on as well. So this was an interesting case which presented in that regards. Now, as discussed, there can be multiple genes which may be defective in ovarian development. They can include the WT1, which of course we discuss a lot about XY. XX also can present. Danish dash-like picture, NR5A1 again with adrenal failure. You can have abnormality in very proximal genes like WNT4 and RSPO1, which are involved in initial ovarian stabilization, then FOXL2, NOBOX, FIGLA. So there are multiple genes now which we know are essential for ovarian development and sustenance. If there are problem there, they will present more with these situations and they become important in that setting. So there are many other aneuploidy syndromes like trisomy 18, 13, 21, which we discussed earlier. And genetic disorders like galactosemia, myotonic dystrophy, and DNA repair syndrome, which can present. In our list, we did not have spider. So, of course, there can be so many genes which are there, but you can't remember everything in that regards. Now, these are now known to cause 15 to 20% of your presumed premature ovarian insufficiency. So, if you have a high FSH and karyotype is essential, karyotype is normal, you may still have some of these defects. Now, whether you want to do it will depend upon the availability, the cost, and the clinical presentation. If there are clinical features of syndromic, like the case which you discussed, syndromic was hypertension. That's why we did it. Segregating, as you said, there is a family history. Severe, now what will be severe? You can't have much severe because everybody will present with the same phenotype. So if you have a specific feature, then you should do a NGS, not everybody, at least at the moment, unless the NGS becomes much less, much more affordable. 10-year-old girl with delayed puberty, no breast, no pubic hair, height is short. Now, workup was done. FSH is 21. What do you think, Cyan, with this sort of a report?
Sir, this is a short, it's a Turner syndrome.
What about the FSH report? Is it high?
It is mildly high, so we consider.
So you have to consider other possibilities. So Turner's is of course a possibility, but this is not that high because all your reports were 75, 100, 90. What about your case?
51.
So it was high. So this is like 21. Think of other possibilities as well. So karyotype was normal. So the possibility then was that this child had a brachymetacarpia and this turned out to be a case of pseudohypoparathyroidism. This is rare. I have seen a couple of cases also, but this is an important differential to consider. You can make a diagnosis clinically. 15-year-old girl with primary amenorrhea, Dr. Naveen, no breast, no pubic hair, height is 152, weight is 52. Now, what will you do? Gonadotrophin levels 67.
So? So now we have a height is somewhat changing the normal. So
karyotype, anyway, you will do. So karyotype, there was mild hirsutism, there was large ovarian cysts, and there was a XX karyotype. What are you thinking of?
So LH
receptor defect, you won't have large cyst. Aromatase deficiency. Aromatase or POR will be the possibility. So you have got a girl who is not very tall, normal sort of a height, very high FSH. You excluded Turner syndrome, large ovarian cyst. Again, aromatase POR will be the most likely possibility, which was found, and there was a history of maternal virilization aromatase deficiency. So we have tried to look at the different forms of spectrum of congenital hypergonadotropic hypogonadism beyond Turner syndrome, and we have focused on that. All of you can go and have a look at, we'll load up this presentation also on YouTube as well as our website as well. You can explore our courses also, which are available for fellowship and diploma courses, our book and the mobile application. We'll now take up a few questions which are there before closing. So I think there is a question which is there from Dr. Elizabeth. The second patient had an absent uterus, but with HRT achieved menarche. Now, this is something which we wanted to give as a big message also. So this patient actually did not have an absent uterus. The radiologist had reported it as an absent uterus. And this is a common situation, because if there is no breast development, the uterus is paper thin. And often a transabdominal ultrasound may miss it. So somebody who is not sensitive enough may report it as an absent uterus. So this is not absent uterus. If there is no breast development, do not get an ultrasound done, because again, this will give you a false diagnosis. This is one of the many cases that we have seen who have been referred as quote unquote absent uterus, and this is a normal uterus which is there. So I think this was a good point which Dr. Elizabeth has brought out. Again, interesting, but it is a practical issue in that regards. Now, there are questions also from Dr. Rashi. If you do androstenedione ion levels in case one, will it confirm 17 beta HSD? Absolutely. So I would say the most important investigation in that case will be androstenedione ion. And that's, we'll try to get it done and we'll update once that's available. Dr. Vidya is asking, what are the karyotype in case one? So karyotype, yeah. So she, again, this is a very recent case which we have just seen, I think last week or so. She is being advised the karyotype and other workup. It's not available yet, but we'll see, the cost issues were there. Dr. Pragati, for treatment, how long to give estrogen only and when to add progesterone? So I think this is something which we discuss in detail in our pubertal induction. Just to summarize, we'll start off from around 10% to 15% of the usual dose. So it's something like 0.25 milligram of Progynova, or if you're using the patch, you're talking about very small doses of patch. Build it up gradually till around 2 years, maybe around 25% every 6 months increase, to build up around 2 milligrams of Progynova by around 2 years. And then if there is a spontaneous bleeding or if the ET is more than 5 mm, you can add progesterone from that perspective. While sending NGS, would we mention targeted panel? Yes, targeted panel is always better, Dr. Nitin, because if you do a targeted panel, you will get a specific, the range and the reading depth, or the number of times that particular site is checked will be more. So targeted panel will be less expensive, and that will be a better thing for ovarian targeted panel. What we are finding is that compared to many of these biochemical tests, which are also very expensive, may not be giving you the right diagnosis because there can be some other genetic cause. Targeted panels are much better because they give you a precise diagnosis in that perspective.